So hello and welcome to another episode of GDL-IL, Google Developer Live Israel. Today I'm quite happy and very pleased to have my colleague with me, Sam Dutton from London.
Thank you so much. Thanks for inviting me. It's my first time at an Israel GDL, so great to be here.
No, thank you, and hopefully in the near future we'll be able to do it face-to-face here in Campus Tel Aviv, right?
Fantastic. Looking forward.
Excellent. So today we're going to cover some of the new cool things that we have in WebRTC, and maybe the best thing will be if I could just share the slides. We'll have a links for the slides and all the other good stuff that we're going to share with you later on in the footnotes of the GDL page on Google Developer Live, and of course I'll leave it on my blog, and Sam definitely will have it on his blog and his G+ page, and you have the links to both of them in the event itself, so feel free to go there. So so today we're going to speak about WebRTC, and Sam will be able to share with us some of the new cool demos that are just showing the power of this cool API. Maybe the best things will be if, Sam, you could take over and just go us through these slides and some of the great links that we have here.
Absolutely. We've got this new set of technologies called WebRTC. And what that gives us is real-time communication built into the browser. For obvious applications, we can think of things like video chat, exchange of data, low latency between games, stuff like file sharing, even telephony. Now, the point about WebRTC, the way it's been implemented, is that it's peer-to-peer. So the communication is happening between the browsers, between what's called peers. So if we think of technologies like WebSocket, which are really, really fast, but they're going via an intermediary server. And with WebRTC, it's directly between the peers. WebRTC has been built as a free and open source project. So it doesn't need any plugins. And like I say, it's standardized and it's free. It's free for developers to use, and all the technologies are free for the end users as well. If we start, I guess, with the kind of the most important API in this, we've got something called getUserMedia, so also known as MediaStream. Now, the WebRTC APIs have been implemented now in Chrome, on desktop, and on Android, and in Firefox, and we're told coming to Opera on mobile and on desktop, so that's great news. This symbol.info/gum, and you can see there that it's asking me, little permission box up the top there, if I can let it use the camera. So here we are, we're using the camera, and we're getting a video element. You can see the code is pretty simple there. There's, you know, what's that, 20 lines of code to cover cross-browser as well. If you do the stream variable there, that shows us what the stream is coming from the video, and you can see that element, and then if the video tracks for that, that we have one video track. This represents the stuff coming from the camera, and you can see there the name and the label and so on. So a really useful API on its own, kind of fun, but people are doing cool things with this. And when these APIs come up against each other, we see these amazing things. So I love this ASCII camera example. What's happening here, it's actually kind of really simple code. What we're doing is we're getting the video stream from the camera, and we're putting that onto a canvas element, pretty straightforward, and then analyzing each of the pixels of the canvas element and turning that into ASCII. Really, if you look at the code there, it's pretty minimal stuff. So again, this richness where we're getting one API. You can have a look at Webcam Toy, which does the same using WebGL, And audio recorder here. What we're doing is we're using getUserMedia as the input to web audio. If we allow that, you can see I'm getting some visualization there happening with the canvas element again. And I can actually download this content using recorder.js. And if I open up that file in, and see it there in VLC, and I can play that back just there. So again, one API coming up against another in really interesting ways. Speaking of this, actually, you might be interested to check out Media Recorder, link to the API there. This has been implemented in Firefox nightly, and it's coming soon. We've got a intensive implement in Chrome, which is great. So yeah, that's going to be the ability to record audio and video files. And again, some links to some API stuff there. Now, to do something more powerful, the kind of core of WebRTC, we've got this API, RTC peer connection, and this is the API for peer-to-peer communication. So the obvious stuff for this is the ability to do stuff like video chat, and also but also could be used by the API called RTCDataChannel. Let's slightly swap these over there. We'll fix these up anyway. So what this allows us to do is video chat between browsers. We've got a link to an application there. What I'd really recommend, if you want to get your head around RTC peer connection, is to have a go at the code lab there on Bitbucket. Really straightforward stuff. And we will fix up the labels on these pages, which are back to front. Now, there's also a part of RTC peer connection, which is RTC data channel. This is the API for arbitrary data communication between peers. And some examples here. Let's have a look at this is using the API for file sharing. If I select, let's select a file here. So this is a photograph of our local pub, and we're using the RTC data channel API to share this. Now, if I open this in a new on a new machine, but you can see that I've actually downloaded that by sharing peer-to-peer, and if I open it up, I should be able to see. Maybe not. Okay, not with this. Anyway, I've downloaded the file there. This is a great way to do file sharing. If we go back, I'll just show you another link there to a project called PeerCDN. Now, this is really interesting. This is the idea of sharing content using RTC data channel to enable content distribution peer-to-peer. So it's something really radical. We'll see how the future pans out, but this could be a completely different way of sharing content on the internet, kind of maybe the peer-to-peer dream come true. Would also strongly recommend you take a look at the wonderful Cube Slam game there. You can play with friends via WebRTC or with a bear. So just to keep going, some more great stuff coming into media on the web. We have an API, JavaScript API called Encrypted Media. This is an extension to HTML media element. It gives us the ability to deal with encrypted media on the web. So simple cases like, say, maybe corporate presentations where we're just sharing a password, to more complex applications where we're using a plugin, what's called content decryption module, for stuff like Netflix and so on, where we have a more complex schedule set up and so on. So a way for content distributors to use the web with encrypted media extensions. Now, this has been implemented using something called media source extensions. Media source extensions are a way of chunking up bits of video, other content potentially, and then playing them back using a JavaScript interface. Kind of simple. Here, if you follow the link, kind of doesn't do much, but what we're seeing here is the ability to get chunks of video and then play them back using the media source extensions API. That kind of works, but what makes it really powerful is the ability to use this with stuff like what's called Dash, MPEG Dash, to do adaptive streaming. That means that we can change, depending on the bandwidth conditions and so on, we can change the actual quality of the resolution of the video that's being downloaded in real time. So very, very useful. And, you know, in this modern world where we've got, I heard that like Cisco estimating something like 80 to 90% of video web traffic will be video within the next kind of three years. YouTube, you know, we've already got something like 100 hours of video uploaded each minute, 6 billion views a month and so on. And in that context, stuff like adaptive streaming with MSC is going to be really, really important. But also the use of really good codecs. Google's working on a codec called VP9, which is source and royalty-free video standards. If we look at the demo here, this is kind of showing, yeah, full screen there. This is showing VP9 in comparison with H.264, and you can see it's comparing very favorably there with an existing technology. There's nothing we can compare with H.264. Let's go out of full screen there.
Sam, maybe you could repeat the last sentence because I think we couldn't hear it well.
Oh, sorry, yeah. So the demo there is, people might think that's an unfair comparison because it's not comparing with H.265, the next version, following on from H.264, also known as HEVC, confusingly. We don't have a playback mechanism for that that we can compare with in that way, but really to show that VP9 is comparing very favorably, certainly with existing encoding technology there. And yeah, there's a stack more links if you'd like to find out more about VP9. It's really, thinking about coping in this coming world where we have HD on the rise, we have broadcasters moving to IPTV, in other words, broadcast over the internet. And I saw some figures the other day, like for the BBC here in the UK, TV viewing is still, broadcast is still pretty much all, it's like all still on televisions. Something like only 1%, I think, 2% maybe of people here are watching TV on the internet. So, there's a huge opportunity there. There's going to be a huge shift in the way people view TV. So we really...
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, I agree. And I think there was a very interesting blog post that showed the stats of Netflix in the U.S., and obviously it will go to other markets as well, that the numbers there are just staggering. Like you said, basically, on what we have today in YouTube, it's...
Yeah, that's right. We've got this huge move from it's video viewing onto the internet. And I think I saw some figures from the US that people are now spending more time on the internet and a lot of that watching video. And that's going to require, these really good technologies like MSC and great codecs like VP9 for the internet to keep going. So, yeah, some great stuff there. And, check out the links. There's a whole stack more material there.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And maybe we'll just go for the last... Oh, by the way, I wanted to ask you about the encrypted media because I got... questions from startups that want to try and start playing or, let's say, developing and check this technology. Where does it stand today in terms of enabling us to encrypt, decrypt on the client, and what can you share with us in terms of where this project is going?
So over the next couple of months, we're going to actually be producing something called kind of EME in a box. So this is going to be a kind of complete kind of starter pack for people who want to have a go with EME. In the meantime, I would check out the links that we've got there. Actually, I can share some more stuff later, some more resources about how EME works and how you might implement it in your project. But we will be producing some more materials, resources for developers so that they can integrate the encryption part, key servers, and the actual web applications in their infrastructure.
Excellent.
Their
Excellent. So, yeah. So
we'll keep you posted. We'll distribute that stuff. It will be available in the next month or two.
Great. And then last but not least, we put some links to resources. So of course we'll have the recording. So people that weren't with us, and I know there are a few that would love to see the recording. So of course we'll have a link there. And there's a Google I/O presentation on WebRTC. I highly recommended it. I watched it live and then watched it again like 3-4 weeks ago, and it's a great presentation. And then we have two tutorials on HTML5 ROC about WebRTC basics, and an ebook or paper pack that you could purchase. And I think
that's great. The book is brilliant. I really like that. It's downloaded to your ebook reader. And it's just come out in the second edition. We'll actually put a link there too. The other resource I would recommend, shameless self-promotion, but is the code lab that we did at Google I/O. That shows you how to make a complete video chat application, including how to build it. Really, really simple, how to build a signaling server using Node.js and Socket I/O.
Excellent. That sounds brilliant. And then we put a link to just to show where, or for developers that want to see, you know, what are their users using, and then plan ahead and see. So as you mentioned, it's supported today in Firefox and Chrome, and hopefully Opera will join the gang soon. And so that's
we'll see what happens elsewhere.
So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, no, that's great. You also might want to check out chromestatus.com. We'll put a link to that too. This tells you the implementation status of APIs in Chrome and Chromium. Great resource, just been relaunched. So yeah, that's another good way to find out when things are on the way, how standardization's going, and so on.
Yeah, absolutely. .com/features. I really like the new addition to see exactly which API is going to be supported and which platforms, and some great work over there.
Yeah, beautiful piece of work. That's really nice.
Excellent. So I think we are just on time. I would like to thank you very much for joining us and putting some lights on this cool new technology.
Oh, thanks everyone there for joining us, and apologies for the confusion of RTC Data Channel and Peer Connection. We'll put some more links up there. Hope it's useful. Please, you know, if you're working on stuff, please feel free to contact us. And any bugs with the APIs, we really appreciate, you know, all the bugs reports we've had and feature requests and all that stuff. crbug.com/new. That's the place for your comments on the WebRTC APIs. So thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. So thank you very much, and until next time, be strong. Bye-bye.
See ya.